Hello, everyone. This is Chris Zorich, and you're watching the Zorich podcast. I have a very special guest. I'm kind of my fellow brother. We're actually captains our senior year at Notre Dame. However, he did a lot more than that. He's a Notre Dame legend, Super Bowl champion as well, five-time Pro Bowler, and in my opinion, should have already been in the NFL Hall of Fame, but I know he's going to be there very soon. Everybody, we'll be interviewing. I'll be interviewing Ricky Waters as soon as we come back.
Yeah,
all right. How's that for big time graphics, man?
I like that, man. You know what I'm saying? The music's hot.
Hey, man, we're trying. That I can thank my producer slash director slash wife for all that, because I know nothing about social media, and she's the one who put that together. So if you have any issues, you can talk to my wife about it.
I definitely don't have an issue. I was just going to say thank you.
We have a lot to cover. First of all, I mean, how are you guys? How's the family doing in this kind of chaotic COVID environment? Everybody safe? Right.
Man, actually, we're doing great. You know, considering that we have to do a lot of homeschooling and, sure, you know, and all that kind of stuff. One of the craziest things for us was my older son. He went to college, you know, he goes to St. Mary's. And so he's a freshman. And just imagine your freshman year, you finally get out of the house and, you know, he's at the dorms. He's coming into his own, I'm sure, feeling good about himself. And next thing you know, you got to come on back home with mom and dad in the same old room that you used to have, you know. So that was the hardest thing. And them on Zoom and trying to help them and running around trying to make it, you know, happen for them when they know more about the social media than we do.
Sure, absolutely, absolutely.
So, you know, it's tough that way, but we know that other people are having a lot tougher time than that. So, you know, we keep telling them, man, don't complain about these things, because it could be a lot worse.
That is very true. It's kind of interesting. It's one of the, I guess, one of the positive things you can kind of experience in this environment is literally families are back together.
Yeah.
And, you know, that could be good or bad. I mean, but as a whole, you know, you have families back together. And like you said, you know, you have kids in college. My wife and I have our daughter is actually at St. Mary's at Notre Dame, and not the same St. Mary's as your son, but she's also a freshman. And so it's that idea that, you know, families are now closer. And like I said, it's either good or bad.
Yeah, and I have to say that it's been, even though, like I said, he came back and it's like, man, what is going on, and trying to help him through that. But it has been very good for all of us. We bonded during this time. He and I both love music, and, you know, he's much more accomplished than I am at it. But we've been able to work together and do some music together and stuff like that. It's just a lot of fun. My younger son, Shane, the same thing. And we're here working out. Like every day we're hitting, we got a slam man and we're beating him up and everything, working our swords and stuff. You know, we do a lot of martial arts.
Nice. So who's the one doing the video? Because as I was doing my research, I saw a video. Which son is that?
Yeah, that's my oldest one. And
okay.
Yeah, he's right now, he's doing just a little, that I was showing his rehabbing, because he had to get surgery on his knee.
Okay. Okay.
He's only like 3 weeks to a month of out, and he's already doing that, moving around and boxing like that. So that's why I wanted to show that, you know,
nice, how
he's moving and coming along, and also the great job that Dr. Ting, shout out to Dr. Ting, in Fremont, holla at my man if you need some help with anything. He's awesome.
All right, so the idea that I've known you more than half my life is really crazy. It's scary that like we're getting old. I mean, you know, my birthday's in March, yours in April, and you know, we're 51. Like we're grown-ups. It's crazy. Yeah.
We got too much responsibility now.
Seriously,
crazy. We don't want all of this.
Well, it's funny because I was talking to Tim Ryan, and he was telling me, well, we were just kind of messing around a little bit, and he was telling me that, Chris, do you realize that we are now the age of my parents, when my parents were coming up and like traveling to all the games and stuff, like watch us, we're their age. And I was like, are you kidding me? That's scary. Jeez. Scary.
It is scary.
All right, so I'm gonna go back to Ricky Waters playing Pee Wee League. So how did you get involved in football?
Well, it's really funny how it happened for me. I thought I was gonna be a basketball player. I loved basketball, and I was always playing and going down to the courts and with the older kids and trying to hang out. But really how it happened for me in football was I was just playing sandlot, and I was playing with good kids that were older than me. I mean, these guys would hammer me, and we didn't have any pads on, and they would knock the wind out of me and everything. I'd go home crying. You know, if it's my ball, I take my ball. I'm out of here, yo.
Right.
I'm gonna hurt somebody, you know. It was that sort of thing. But I didn't understand how they were making me so tough, and they were making me to the point where when I started playing Pee Wee League, it was like I get to play with these kids that are actually my size, you know, and they're not as fast as these other guys, are not as agile and everything, and obviously as strong as they were. And it just took off for me. Football really started to take off for me from the time I started playing. They call me White Shoes.
How old were you?
I was about 7 years old.
Oh, really? Wow. Okay. Yeah, this is back in Harrisburg, right?
Yep. Yep. Wow, and I went to Catholic school my whole life. So, you know, I went to Our Lady of the Blessed Sacrament was the school. And that was from first grade all the way up to eighth grade. So I played for that school, you know, and grade school. And so it was kind of easy for me, you know, out there playing with those guys. And I was, you know, having a lot of fun. And I was running back. I was number 44.
Wait, like so you were running back then? Shoes. You weren't even like a quarterback or a lineman? You were running back back then?
Yep, I was a running back first. And what's funny is that I was a running back first, but I played all these different positions that really helped me in high school and especially for college, because when I came out, I was like the number one recruit in the country because of my all the different skill sets that I had. The fact that I could play wide receiver, like I wasn't the top running back. Emmitt Smith had that pleasure, but so he came out with us too. He came out with me. So, but I played quarterback, I played wide receiver, you know, split end and splinker. I played running back, I played defensive back, so I could play cornerback or safety. And then I did the punt returns and the kick returns, as you know. So, you know, I think that's why people, you know, I was so sought after. So I'm glad that I played different positions as I came up. That's why I had the number 12, actually, because in high school was when I changed to the number 12 and I was quarterback.
Okay.
And I ran more touchdowns than I threw, you know.
Nice. Like, you remember how many yards you had as a quarterback?
Excuse me?
Do you remember how many yards you had as a quarterback?
Oh, no, I don't. I was a freshman, and I was on the freshman team. So I had a lot of yards, but, you know, they wasn't really keeping the stats like that. They were, but I don't remember them. And but the great thing about it was that my coach from the varsity team was coming to check me out, because people were saying, man, you got to look at this kid that's on the freshman team. And, you know, normally they don't really check us out, but he came to check us out and everything. And I had a really good, great game. And right away he was like, we need you up on the varsity. So then right after that year, they put me on the varsity. So from my sophomore year, I was on varsity, and he put me at running back. And that's when I started playing running back.
So did you have any kind of idols? I mean, you mentioned why you got number 12. Was it number 12 because of somebody, or was it just 12 because you could play both quarterback and running back with that number?
I loved Roger Staubach.
That's awesome. Are you serious?
I loved Roger Staubach. I loved the Dallas Cowboys. Can you believe that? 49er fans, can you believe that? When I was young, I loved them, and I just thought they were so cool. And then when Tony Dorsett went there, he's from Pennsylvania, and, you know, I'm from Pennsylvania, so I was just like, man, this is my team right there. So I loved that number 12, and and even though I was playing running back, I still wanted to rock it, and he let me. And, you know, back in high school, I don't know, did you go both ways too? Because back then we used to go both ways.
Well, you had to, yeah. I mean, high school, yeah, it was crazy.
Yeah, I never came off the field. Only time I came off the field was for kickoffs or punts.
Wow.
The rest of the time I was in the field. So it was a lot of fun for me. You know, I was real skinny. You know, when I came in, even when I came in Notre Dame, I was pretty skinny.
It was hilarious. I have my own story for that that we'll get to later.
My big neck rope on.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and then you would duct tape it just to make it bigger.
Trying to look bigger.
So we talked about high school a little bit. I mean, did you have any other relatives who played sports, or were you the only person? Were you the one that was kind of the chosen one, or how'd that look?
Yeah, as far as my family's concerned, I mean, I grew up with a sister. It was just my sister.
Okay.
And, she's like 6 years older than me. She used to compete me in running and everything.
Nice.
And all that stuff. She was way tougher than me and everything when I was younger, when I first started playing and all that. But made me tougher, you know.
Okay.
She played basketball and stuff like that, but no one else. My dad played baseball, and that was his sport. But, you know, basketball was my thing. But then football, it just came to me, and it just was something that just took off for me. There were other players, though, around that were pretty good, you know, pretty special. We had Mike Owens was a guy who was a really good running back who I was kind of patterning myself after as I was moving up, kind of watching this guy. He was he was only like a year older than me, but he was so smooth. He ended up going to Syracuse.
Okay.
And then, you know, in high school, I had a couple running backs that – were a year before me at Bishop McDevitt, where I went to high school.
Right.
And those guys, one was Sean Borowski. He went to Penn State.
Okay.
And James Bryant, he went to Ohio State. So those were other guys that helped me a lot and helped
That's
me.
Amazing, so that was kind of like a powerhouse. That was a powerhouse school.
Yeah, we were a powerhouse school. Actually, Shady McCoy, you know, the Sean McCoy, he went there as well. That's my little brother. So, you know, I got to give him a shout out. That's man.
That's amazing. I bet it's hard to get into. I mean, you've done very well for yourself, but it's kind of hard to get into the high school, your high school Hall of Fame, huh? Because there's a whole bunch of people in there.
Yeah, big time. I mean, it's awesome now. It's a huge school. It was a smaller, like a real small private school at the time, and but now it's like a big campus. It's really awesome, and I like to say it's because of all the success that we had, you know.
Of course.
Man, I helped you build this, so y'all better be happy. Y'all got this awesome school and this awesome field. We used to have a big ball spot down the middle when we were playing.
That's insane. So what did you always play? Did you play any other sport in high school, or is it always football? Did you play basketball in high school?
I played basketball in high school.
Okay.
And the truth is – the difference between me probably still trying and hold on to that basketball dream and not follow the football dream was my coach.
Really?
My coach, Tim Renfrew, he was awesome coach in football, and he was more than just a coach. You know, one of those guys that was a mentor for me. You know, you got to have those guys. My dad was definitely very instrumental in my life. He was a military guy, tough. Made me hard, made me the man I am today. But Coach Renfrew will help me out a lot as well.
So he didn't make you choose. He just kind of talked to you more about getting involved in football, or?
Yeah, he didn't care if I played both.
It was okay.
The basketball coach wanted me to play all year round basketball.
Right.
And I'm like, I can't do that. You know, I want to play football, and I love this coach, and I thought he was so cool. And the more I was around him, and he just made me feel really good to the point that I was like, you know what, it's okay. I don't have to play basketball.
Well, you know, I'm sure there was a huge following for your football team in your high school as well. So, I mean, you know, it sounds like one of those kind of East Coast powerhouses where, you know, parents got involved, you know, the alumni would come back for games and stuff like that. Like, yes. I'm assuming your Friday nights were, like, huge.
Yeah, big time. And we had a little stadium, and it was just bleachers on the one side.
Really?
People were all up on the roof. They had roofs, you know, rooftops over there. And then, and the park is right there, and it's like a big hill that goes up.
Okay.
Sit all on, along that hill to watch us and everything. So it was crazy how many fans we would have there watching us play. And it was just awesome to be a part of that as well. And, yeah, it was fun to play there. It was fun to play at Bishop McDevitt. I mean, we didn't have the band. Harrisburg High, they had the band, you know. They, the cheerleaders, they was all, you know, smooth and all that kind of stuff. But we had the team.
So were you recruited by them, or did you have a chance to go to different other high schools? Like, how did that work out for you? Did they, you know, offer a scholarship, or how did that work?
I don't know if they recruit or if they recruited anybody else.
Right.
But they didn't have to recruit me. My sister went there.
Okay.
My cousins went there. That's the school that, you know, my parents had already. My parents were like that. They're like, look, we're going to make sure you do the right things. We're going to make sure that you have the right path going along. And the same thing when it came time for going to colleges. And I mean, I could have went anywhere in the country.
Right.
And my parents were like, they started out with like, you know, we know we train, you know, we obviously raised you right. And you're, you know, great young man, you worked for this, you deserve this and everything. So, you know, we know you're going to make the right decision. And then it turned into, we ain't going to let you make the wrong decision. I don't know what you're talking about, but you ain't going to Florida or UCLA or anywhere like that. They were like Notre Dame. You get a chance to go to Notre Dame. They said Notre Dame or West Point or one of the Ivy League schools. So where you want to go?
Wow. That's interesting. So when did the recruiting process start for you? A lot of folks have started maybe their junior year. You start kind of talking about schools and stuff like that. Was it like that for you?
I started getting letters when I was like a sophomore. I remember my first letter was Prairie View A&M.
Really? That's awesome.
And I kept showing people. I didn't even know where it was. But I was out there, had that letter. I'm showing them my letter, showing people and everything. And then, of course, you know, more started coming from all these different places. And then bigger name schools. And then I just couldn't believe it, man, how amazing it got for me. Because, I mean, like Oklahoma and Nebraska, I'm watching these. They were great back then. You know, they wanted me for quarterback.
Sure.
A lot of other teams wanted me for running back. Penn State wanted me for running back. Pitt, a lot of those schools. UCLA, they wanted me for a defensive back. So
really?
It was a lot of different ways that people were saying that they were going to use me. And
okay.
So it was really cool to get so much attention in the beginning. But then it just got to the point where I had to hide out. I wasn't even coming home. I was like, man, I cannot take it no more, man.
Wow.
So I just was like, I got to make a decision. And I already knew what the decision was going to be, unless I don't want to be home no more. I want
my let's back up a little bit. All right. So what were your final five visits? Final five schools.
Yeah, it was Notre Dame, Tennessee, Florida, Michigan, and UCLA.
Okay, I mean, those are when you look at the map, those schools are all over. Like, how did Michigan get in there?
It was exactly that way. Well, number one, I like those coaches. They're, you know, Bo Schembechler was cool.
Right.
The coaches were cool. I had already went to Penn State. I had unofficial visits to Penn State, Pitt, West Virginia, all the schools like Maryland, all the schools right around me. I checked those out on my own. So I had never been anywhere. I'd never gone anywhere outside of Harrisburg, really. So I was like, man, I want to see what it's like down south. So I picked a school down south. I wanted to see what it was like in Florida and, of course, in L.A. And then Notre Dame, you know, that had to be in there. And then Michigan was just a powerhouse at the time, too. And they really recruited me well.
Okay, so I can understand Florida. I can understand Tennessee. Those are SEC schools. I mean, I'm assuming you had a good time at those schools. Is that correct?
Oh, my God, yeah.
And then I'm assuming when you took your visit to Notre Dame, it was probably either snowing or raining, right?
It was my worst visit.
Help me out here, man.
It was my worst visit by far.
Do you remember who your host was?
I have Mark Green.
Okay. All right.
So, you know, that's my dude, everything, but it wasn't nothing to do. What could he do? You know, it's just like, you know, you're taking me to the grotto, you know, we seeing touchdown Jesus, we the golden dome, you know, stuff like that. And I was like, where are the girls at? What's going on? You know? And Florida, they had the Gator Getters. I'm talking to girls on the phone. Tennessee, I'm like, man, I already know people there. I'm like, yeah, when I come there, we're going to hang out, right? I'm already talking to people. It's like, it was crazy.
So did you wind up taking all five visits?
And I didn't. I didn't take UCLA would have been my last one. I took all the other ones. But that was when the pressure was just so much that I just said, man, I'm just going to go ahead and – you know, tell everybody Notre Dame and put that Notre Dame hat on because it was just too much.
All right, especially
between Penn State and Notre Dame, it was like, I mean, Joe Paterno and Coach Holtz were just like boom, boom, boom.
Really?
Oh yeah.
Okay, so as you're on the field and making a decision, I mean, how was that? Actually, we had a chance to talk to Pat Terrell, and Pat Terrell gave us a great story about his dad kind of, like on a chart, kind of showed him the value of each of the schools. Like what was the process for you and your family to kind of shift you or to help you make that decision?
Well, Notre Dame recruited me unbelievably. Okay. I mean, it started with Vinny Serrato. Vinny started with him, and then Coach Yelovich. And then it was Coach Holtz. I mean, he came to see me like 3 or 4 times. I mean, it
really?
Was awesome how much he came. You know, he came to the school. He came to see me at a track meet I had. I was running independently, and he came. And also, like, they named a day after me in Harrisburg. So
nice.
For that. So it was a lot of cool things that were happening for me at that time, and he was there, man. He's coming, you know, doing his magic tricks, you know, telling all his jokes and everything.
Right,
you know,
right.
You know, a few lies in here and there, because you gotta tell the young people, man, this is very, very competitive when you're somebody like that. And they're going to tell you anything and everything to get you there.
Of course.
Don't go to a college because of promises. Go because you think it's a great learning environment.
Right.
And it's a place that you can be successful. You see yourself being successful. And I'm glad that I went to a place
right.
that was that.
Mm-hmm. All right. So you mentioned before kind of Paterno and Holtz are kind of battling for you. I mean, what was the – and you didn't take an official visit – to Penn State, but obviously you live in the area, so you've been there several times. I mean, what was the deciding factor between Penn State and Notre Dame?
Yeah, that was a tough one for me, even though that wasn't, you know, one of my official visits.
Right.
That was one I had my eye on big time because, you know, I felt
it was a local. I mean, I'm sure your parents, I mean, look, a couple hours away, right?
Yeah. So everybody was – that was the thing that was kind of interesting about my parents. Everybody else was more excited about Penn State than they were. You know, it was Penn State, you got, man. You know, and people were like, you're not even going to give Penn State a chance. I'm like, oh, no, definitely. And one of my best friends I told you was there, Sean Borowski. He was my fullback.
Okay.
So he's there. So I think they thought I was going to go there. But what happened was they stopped recruiting me so hard. Because they thought they had me.
Okay.
And Notre Dame kept going.
Gotcha.
And they just did a better job of recruiting me. I mean, they really did. And they wowed my parents. And, you know, my mom to this day, well, she passed away now, but, you know, she loved Tony Yelovich. You know, she loved these guys. You know, my dad, he loved Vinny Serrato. You know, so it was like they would talk so much, they became friends.
Wow.
So it was just, I mean, they just did a great job of recruiting me. You already know the type of school it is and everything. So I went to Catholic school my whole life. So, I mean, it wasn't like it was way out of the realm for me of somewhere that I wouldn't mind going, obviously. And then when Coach Oates and them come in and saying, man, you could start for us right now as a senior, you could start for us on our team. And I'm like looking at them and I'm like, man, I think I could start. Man. What about you, man? You know, they only got Tim Brown.
That's the part, ladies and gentlemen, where you got to make sure what the heck is going on, because Tim Brown, he alluded to, wound up winning the Heisman our freshman year. So that was not going to happen. But that's awesome, man. So you made the decision. In our time, it was a little different. I mean, no one had a I don't know, maybe you did, but, you know, there weren't a lot of ESPN press coverage. I mean, I'm sure it was kind of a local thing where the local media, were they all excited for you? Did you have, like, an interview? Did you have, like, a reveal? Like, how was that process?
Yeah, you talking about in high school?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. It was really obviously, it was small time. I mean, mm-hmm. It was Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, but it was as big as it could be for a young guy. Like I said, they, you know, named the day after me and gave me a big plaque and everything. And then they also made me like the Grand Marshal of the St. Patrick's Day Parade.
Wow.
They had me on the, you know, one of those old time cars, convertibles. They had the long dogs, you know, the long Irish dogs with the long hair, skinny dogs walking.
That wouldn't happen if you went to UCLA or Tennessee or something. You would definitely not be the Grand Marshal of the Harrisburg St. Patrick's Day Parade. Definitely not what happened. I'm sure you were the first Black Irish person they had for their Grand Marshal. Definitely.
There's no doubt about that.
And man, also probably the first Notre Dame person, which is actually also pretty good.
Yeah. But it was a fun time. It was a fun time for me.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
It was obviously very exciting.
So a couple things. What is the Big 33 game? And second of all, my introduction to you was before we met, I got Blue and Gold Illustrated, which I'm sure you got way back when. And this was a magazine that eventually they sent to the kids who had already committed to Notre Dame. And so I'm reading through it and I hear Ricky Wallace. And he's like this All-American, this great player. And then I meet him, and I think maybe the first time you may have been wearing a Big 33 t-shirt. I'm not sure. But can you explain to our audience, like, because that was a huge, huge game, right?
Yeah, it is a huge game. It's Pennsylvania versus
Ohio, right?
At that time, it was Maryland.
Okay, Maryland. I'm sorry.
It's Maryland. But we've played against Jersey. We played against Texas. We played against a lot of different states, but this one was against Maryland, which was very interesting because there was a guy on Maryland's team that ended up playing with us named Andre Jones, and he gave it to me in that game. It was so crazy because one of the times I broke away, and I was just like, yeah, I'm going. You know, I'm used to once I break away, that's it. I don't even worry about nobody behind me. This mug ran up behind me, knocked the ball out, made me.
Are you serious?
Doing everything, man. Andre was balling. I think he had an interception. He definitely had a sack.
Oh my God!
And I was like, man, I've never seen a linebacker that fast. So it was just crazy to see that. But yeah, that's a big game for us, you know. It's a great honor for us to be able to play in the Big 33, and especially to be a captain of the team. And I was captain, and I got a big trophy for a player of the year that they give out at that thing too. Some guys were mad at me after that.
So needless to say, you guys beat Andre or what?
Lewis Riddick was on my team. You know,
Riddick. Wow. Yeah, absolutely.
He thought he should have got it. He was mad at me, but then we became friends after that.
So you guys wound up winning it, right? You guys beat Maryland?
No, they beat us. Yeah, I think they beat
us. And you still got it.
Yeah.
Nice. So did you know Andre was going to Notre Dame at the time, or had you guys met before? Or
we hadn't met before that, but then after that we talked and everything and became friends. Like, you know, we were very good friends once we got to college. You know, he was him and Todd, probably the two guys that I knew the most when I first got there. For some reason, I knew Todd too, because I was seeing him and hearing about him and So I felt like I knew him. So when I was there, you know, I met him and talked to him. So
okay, so now we're going to move from Harrisburg to good old South Bend, Indiana. So I remember a whole bunch of stories. Some of them I can't tell, some of them I can't. The first story that I wanted to rip your head off, I think, if I remember correctly, I was in the weight room. I was lifting, and I used to have a stuttering problem. And lo and behold, my boy, Ricky, who eventually became my captain, started to tease me about it. Now,
I was immature back then, though, you know.
I'm lifting weights. So I remember, and unfortunately, he was a wee bit faster than I was. So I got off the weights, obviously pissed. So I'm chasing down, wasn't happening. But I remembered, and I think maybe about a week later, I got you in a kind of a hole that wouldn't let you go. And I was hey, what's happening now? What's happening now? So that was my introduction to the legend of Ricky Waters. But I do have to say that, you know, it was really encouraging because I really think our class, and obviously the class before us with Pat and Smigallon, those guys were really good players.
Yeah.
Wait, I mean, Stoney, Dean Brown, all those guys. But, dude, it was something about our class, man. I mean, you know, it was the swag.
Yeah.
A lot of the older guys didn't have. And, you know, it was this level of kind of, I want to say confidence that, you know, we had that I don't think Notre Dame realized. And I'm not sure if Lou Holtz found us and said, oh, hey, this guy's this, this guy's that, this guy's this. I mean, you know, we got there and, you know, half the freshmen at least started or at least got some time. And I'm talking about everybody from – Frank Jacobs to Tim Ryan to Andre to you. I mean, everybody was playing. And the only thing I could remember, I remember somebody telling me that the difference between our class and the rest of the guys, we wore like jeans and t-shirts to class. And the other guys wore like khakis and polos.
And they were big weird.
Exactly. Right, exactly. But I know that sounds weird, but that was kind of like it was almost like we didn't care, and we kind of knew how good we are. What was your take on the fact that we were these knucklehead freshmen coming in thinking we ruled the world?
Yeah, I just, man, that was some of the most fun. Was first of all, like I said, you know, in high school being like a really, you know, one of the ones to stand out, and then to get there and see all the talent that was there when we first got there, it was just amazing. But then to see other guys come,
right,
Stan Smigala, guys like that, you know, I'm like, hold on, what's going on, man? This white dude is like beating me in these 40s. dashes. I'm like, where'd you come from, man? It's just right. So fast and everything. But those were the kind of athletes that we had. And we had that confidence that no matter how good they were, and obviously they had Tim Brown in their class. You know, they had Brandy Wells, all those guys. They had some really good players. But we always felt like we're going to top them. You know,
what do you think it was, though? I mean, we all got recruited. I mean, what do you think it was with our class kind of – and I don't want to say it was a chip on our shoulder, but what do you think made our class kind of the one that people paid attention to? I mean, yeah, we had great athletes, but every class has great athletes. It was kind of like it was something else. I mean, what do you think it was? And I may be wrong. I don't know. But
well, I feel like we was, I don't know. We were just so close. We loved being around each other. We could, like you said, we could clown each other. We could joke and do things that I didn't see the other classes doing as much. I saw them more like. Each person was their own man, kind of going their own way. Of course, they were all team players.
Right.
But kind of trying to find their way. But we we were kind of like, we came in talking about we're public enemy. Remember, we were like saying we're public enemy and all this stuff. So we already had that swag. But we felt like a group. We didn't feel like individuals, and we didn't seem like individuals when we were practicing or playing. And even afterwards, we would all hang. I mean, just when I really think about how much we used to hang, all of us, and how we would always see each other. We'd always end up at the same house party or something. We'd always end up, you know, on the north side of the quad, you know, up way up somewhere with where Pat and them was. They always had the nice the little double hookup. So we was going to go there and hang out. Because I had a little, I thought I wanted, I remember.
Were you in Pangborn? What dorm were you in? Were you in Pangborn?
I was in Fisher at first.
Oh, Fisher. Okay. All right. Okay.
And I had a closet because I said I wanted a single. You know, I'm thinking I'm the man. I'm a single.
You got a closet.
You know, I had this little closet they gave me.
God.
And so right away I started getting like claustrophobic in that mug after a while once it starts snowing and everything. And I'm just like, man, I'm in this closet. If I didn't have if I didn't have a loft, I wouldn't have had a place for my desk. Everything was underneath my loft, and that was my room. So right away, I was like, I don't really like this room. And right. So I started, then I was able to switch out, and I started rooming with Todd.
Okay.
And Andre.
Okay.
And then, you know, so I was over there with them, and then it started really being fun from there. Because, man, hanging with those guys and rooming with those guys is crazy.
So I'm gonna take a little break here, but when we come back, I want to talk about. It's gonna be a short break, but I want to talk about kind of the relationships that were forged during that time. And you mentioned Todd, and you mentioned Andre Jones, who unfortunately is no longer with us. But I do want to talk about kind of those relationships that were forged. So give me a couple seconds here. That was our little commercial break there. All right. So talking about forging relationships and, you know, these are formative years, you know, you do great in high school, but you know, when you get to college, and this is athlete, non-athlete, I mean, you get to college and, you know, these are relationships that help you become the people you are. And
yes.
You mentioned having a forging relationship with Andre and Todd Light. Can you talk about those guys a little bit?
Yeah, well, man. Actually, I had a lot of friends. Obviously, we all hung out. But, you know, rooming with those guys, I got to know them a lot better. They were like the best guys ever. They really were. And it's just like when you start to hang with somebody and you, like, start to know what they're going to say before they say it, and they know what you're going to say before you say it. They know your mannerisms, you know theirs. It's that kind of thing, man. We're so tight and don't want to go anywhere without each other. You know, dude, what you about to do, man? Because I'm about to go to this thing. You want to go with me?
Right.
It was always that way. And what, even when right now, my best friends, you know, I played obviously at three different pro teams and had made friends there, but my real friends to this day is still Gosh Smith, Rocket Ishmael. We talk all the time. You know, Pat Terrell, we're tight. You know, Tony, we're tight. Me and you are tight. Yeah, I mean, it's just like you could go on and on. G. Willie, you know, another one that's not with us anymore. But the way we could joke with each other, the way we could laugh all night, the way we didn't even have to have somewhere to go or something to do to have fun.
Right.
You know, like we said, it wasn't it wasn't a party school, you know, that we went to, obviously, but we had so much fun, and we had to, I kind of liken it to when you're a kid and you didn't have all these video games and all that stuff. You had to go outside and have fun. You know, you had to find fun. You had to play different games that were fun and make fun. And that's what I feel like we did all the time. We were always thinking of what can we do to have fun. I remember playing in, I mean, I really had, there was a lot of things that I did there, you know, besides playing football. I played in the bookstore basketball.
Yep, right.
You know, I practiced bangle bouts, but my mom was like, oh, no, you're not. You're boxing. Are you crazy? I did not send you to Notre Dame to start trying to box. So she wasn't having that. So that didn't happen. But I played in bookstore basketball twice, and I won the championship. The one year I played with Tony.
Nice. On my team. Do you remember the name of the team?
Yeah, you know, Tony could ball too.
So do you remember the name of the team?
I forgot our name. Something Stars or something like that. We were good though.
Well, it's amazing because the folks who may not know, so the bookstore basketball tournament is, I think, still the largest kind of organized on college campus basketball tournament literally in the world. And it was crazy because I think the rule was you could either have one, I think you're only allowed to have one athlete. Oh, no, you had two athletes.
One basketball player.
Right. That's what it was. Okay. It used to be competitive because the president during the time we were in college was Monk Malloy. And he actually played basketball at Notre Dame when he was younger. Well, not younger, but when he was in college. And he actually also played when he was the president of the university.
I know. I played against Coach Holtz. See? I throw the ball from him and dunked on it. He's mad at me. He tried to push me into the pole.
Well, that is hilarious.
What are you doing?
See, you know, and it's funny because, you know, it's those examples that, let's say, the folks who watch you on TV, the folks who watch our games, they see a certain type of person. And so they may not know, they may not understand kind of how exciting that campus was. And I'm going to talk about a little bit about, selfishly for me, the best times on that campus were during summer school. Oh, because like 90% of the athletes, all the athletes were on campus. And I think there may be only about 100 regular students, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, so literally it was all summer. It was just like hanging out. And yeah. I think our classes, I mean, I forgot what the classes were, but I mean, I remember I took Spanish in summer school, but I think the class were only a couple of hours. And then literally you had the rest of the day free.
Man,
it was like the best thing ever for me, man. I enjoyed the hell out of that.
Me too. And you got a lot of people to play with. It's like I said, it goes back to like when you were a kid, you know, and you can go outside, you know, your friends are outside. They all
literally
play.
Yes.
It was like that, you know, so it was really cool and a great time, man. We were always doing something athletic for the most part, you know, so it was just, yeah, it was so much fun. And definitely one of the best times of my life was.
Do you remember saving up those coupons that they used to give us during the summer? Do you remember those?
Yeah. See, I forgot about all that stuff.
they would give us like, I don't know, I forgot how it worked, but you got a certain amount of meal tickets. And then like, if you didn't use them, I forgot how it worked, but like there was like only, at the time, there was only like one store on campus. No, there were two. So you can go to the huddle, which was kind of like a neighborhood kind of a get together, like a student union type thing. And then you can go to one of the dining, you can go to, I think it was South Dining Hall. They had that little cafe. So like, yes. Those are only two places on campus. And then I remember, and I don't know if you ever did this, but you know, I was kind of hurt for food sometimes. I would hoard all of my coupons. And then right before school started, I would go to the huddle and I would like spend like $500 worth of coupons. I like Pop-Tarts and shit and all this like this crazy, crazy food.
Yeah, but see,
those are
the
memories.
The
see, now, I mean, I don't remember what the hell I got in my philosophy class, but I remember going to the huddle and literally having my, and I had like a little fanny pack, and I remember it was full, and it actually was the fanny. Do you remember they gave us those fanny packs? I forgot what game was after, but they were black. I had our number on there. So I had that all full, and I went, it's, I don't know, I kind of got off on a tangent, but I mean, for me, man, those are the moments that like I really enjoy about that experience, because as you mentioned, you know, you're having fun. You know, you were young. You know, you didn't have responsibilities. I mean, the hardest thing we had to do was study for an exam or go to practice. Right. And then after that, especially during the summer, I mean, you could spend all that stuff hanging out. I mean, I remember you got, and I forgot, I think we're in Fisher or whatever, but I remember, I mean, we used to just kind of hang out. We would watch movies and stuff like that. I mean, it was, for me, man, that was the best time for me was during the summer, man.
Yeah, it really was. Yo, but you ate more than me because you had to feed the muscles, man. This dude, his arms, they bigger than my legs now. So imagine when I was skinny like that. Man, and he didn't want to tell y'all that time. Man, he got me in the lock. I was talking smack, so I deserved it. So he's a good man.
He says that now. Bad.
So we didn't think bad about him. But, man, because I was joking. I'm like you said, man, he finally caught up with me. I didn't know who had me because he had me so tight. I couldn't even turn around to see who had me. And then all I saw was everybody over there on that side of the table because we were in the lunchroom. Uh-huh. Like, oh, please don't. Oh, God, don't break his neck. And I'm like, man, who got me? Who is grabbing me? Is this Bruce Lee or somebody? But I knew it couldn't be Bruce Lee because his arm ain't that big. Man. And then once I realized it was you and you cracked my neck, you went, bah, bah, and, you went and man, after that, man, I saw my life flash before my eyes. I said, I am not messing with that guy.
Not at all, man. So we had a lot of success at Notre Dame. Give me a non-athletic moment that was memorable for you when you were there.
Oh, I think it was cool when Spike Lee came. Remember Spike Lee came? He came and he spoke to us and I kind of like told him I appreciated him and all that kind of stuff, and he talk directly with me, you know what I mean?
Nice.
It was just cool to talk to him and to say something to him, say something back to me and be so positive with it. I mean, it was that in the fact of the people who would come to see us play. You know, we would have some great people who would come see us, and it just, I mean, like, it's just amazing what that university brings. Like,
sure.
Even when we would go play other teams, that's another thing. I mean, I know this is playing, but when we would go play another team and we're at their house and our fans are louder than their fans while we're there, you know, those are the things that I remember. And I remember even there were people like there was a family named the Dieters. And one of their daughters went to Notre Dame.
Okay.
To St. Mary's, I think.
Okay.
But we could go over their house, and it was just like mom, dad, you know what I mean? It was just like, as far as them taking care of us, giving us what we needed, you know, that love that we needed there, giving us those cookies, you know, things like that. The mom was a great homemaker and everything, and love you guys. So in case you guys are looking and checking us out, it was just people like that made it special for me.
Right. So, but along with that, and I didn't know this because Notre Dame is so freaking far from Pennsylvania, but there is this tie between Notre Dame and Pennsylvania. I don't know what it is, but I mean, I don't know if it's just like a Notre Dame is like an East Coast Mecca for them, or Midwest Mecca, but there was this huge following, and I'm sure you felt it when you were at Notre Dame. I'm sure there were people would travel in caravans, not just to see you, but they were great fans that would come up from Pennsylvania just to watch the games.
Yeah, Yeah, my dad was always part of that caravan too, as long as I was there. He's coming in.
But he was amazing, man. Like, I'm meeting like people who were like 80 years old who like never missed a game. Yeah. And I'm like, what are you talking about?
And a lot of them didn't even go to Notre Dame.
Exactly. Exactly.
But they love Notre Dame.
Exactly.
I thought that was special too. To see that. But you know, also Pennsylvania now. Like my man Joe Montana, he's from Pennsylvania.
Right.
Went to Notre Dame.
Right.
Also Niners, so I feel a real connection with that guy, obviously.
All right, well, we're going to talk a little bit about that. But so after you went we have a lot more to cover, and I apologize about the time, but this is just awesome. But you win a national championship. You come back to good old Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. I mean, you have to be treated like a god. You just won a national championship.
Oh, yeah. That was just, like, amazing. Just going back and feeling like a champion, you know, a real champion. I mean, we won a championship in high school, but it was nothing like, obviously, winning that championship the way we did, going undefeated. We actually lost the game the year that we won in high school. So it was my first time going undefeated like that and running the table like that the way we did and playing the way we did. And like I said, you know, with the guys that are to this day my best friends, I mean, it was just amazing. And to go back home and, like you said, big following, Notre Dame following there, really excited about it. And people were just treating me like, man, just amazing. Like you said, I don't want to say it like a god, but it was very close to that.
Well, I could imagine. So let me fast forward a little bit. So you were drafted in the second round, and I think the 45th pick.
Yep.
Is that right?
Yep.
So I was the 49th pick. So we actually share a lot in common. Mm. And I'm going to also tell another story when we practiced against you guys in Germany, but I'm going to hold off on that one for a second. My first away game that I played with the Bears, and this is going to go along with what your story you were talking about. I got off the bus, and there was a vet in front of me, and I was like, hey, where are the fans at? And he looked at me and said, what do you mean? I was like, where's everybody who followed the Bears? They're like, he was like, man, this ain't Notre Dame, man. This is the Bears. And I think that, like, it was the first time it hit me. Kind of like what you're saying, you know, Kyle, we had this amazing following. We get to the pros, it's like a letdown. Like, I mean, and Grant, I mean, you know, we had some great teams, we won the Super Bowl, but I mean, when you traveled, like, there was no fans there. It was so interesting, man.
That is very interesting. That's why I say Notre Dame was amazing in that way. There's no doubt about it. The 49ers have a good, they travel well too, and they have a good fan base. Like, there were times of when we played against Todd and them, and they was at L.A.
Right.
And Fat Terrell. They both was on the same team. And we would play them, and they would get so mad because our fans was louder than their fans at the time.
That is hilarious. All right. So you're playing for the 49ers. I'm playing for the Bears. And we went to Berlin, I think, right?
Because that was the year I got injured. I was injured my first year. I was on IR.
But we actually went that year, right?
Yes.
It was 90. Okay, so you didn't go. But it was interesting because they were giving me all this crap because I was waiting. I was like, yeah, I'm going to finally have a chance to see my boy. And they're like, yeah, he's not here. And I'm like, what do you mean he's not here? I'm like, what's up? So, you know, I was about to show you, you know, what I learned differently from the Bears, you know, but that obviously didn't happen. But, you know, it was kind of interesting because I think that what made the opportunity playing professional so unique was, and let me see if this was the same for you, when the respect that you instantly had in the locker room because you went to Notre Dame. I'm assuming it was like that for you, but for me it was kind of interesting because it was almost like the player, even the vets were like, oh, you went to Notre Dame. Like, it was something special. Oh, yeah. And I was amazed by that. And they kind of treated me differently. Like, I wound up being like a player rep when I was with the Bears. And every time somebody had a question, they would always run to me. And I felt that way because I talked to other guys, Tony and Todd and Pat. And same thing for them. Like when guys had questions in the locker room, they would always seek out the Notre Dame guys. So I was wondering if that ever happened to you.
Yep. And actually, except for the Niners, I was a captain on every team I was, you know, that I played for. For the Eagles, I was a captain all the 3 years. And the 3 of the 4 years that I was there in Seattle, I was captain as well. So
that's awesome. That is awesome.
And that says a lot. That's people voting you. You know, you have to be voted captain in the pros. So it was that. That was the same way for me. People wanted to talk to me. They knew that I could speak well and I could speak for them. And if they wanted somebody to talk to the coach, you know, it would be me, you know, go talk to him for us. And kind of tired, man, we can't.
Right, what you did, I'm sure.
Double days, you know, because back then it was like double days and we had pads on twice a day and all that. They were like, man, go talk to him.
So, correct me if I'm wrong here, you won a state championship. You won a national championship.
They didn't have a state championship at that time, but
they didn't. Okay. All right. National championship, and you won a Super Bowl.
Yes.
So, I mean, what's that feeling when you've had a chance to be the best at every level? I mean, what? And I'm not asking you to compare them because at different stages of your life, you accomplished those things. So it's not going to be comparable. But, I mean, what is it like to be part of an elite, fraternity of people who won a national championship in college and also Super Bowl?
Man, it feels really good. But it also reminds me of all the great players that I played with because, obviously, I couldn't do that by myself. So, and the great coaches that I've had a chance to get tutelage from and those people that helped me along the way. Like I said, I had a great coach in high school.
Right.
And a great coaching staff and also a great coaching staff at the 49ers, of course, but also at Notre Dame. You know, a great coaching staff and it's just all that goes together, you know, and it's just super that I have been able to play on those teams. You know, I feel like I played on arguably one of the best teams ever in college history. That's how I feel. I feel like our team could play against anybody and hold our own. I felt like our team at the Niners, we could play against anybody and hold our own. So that's what I look at and I just say, wow, you know, it's just amazing to be a part of that. You know, the fact that I was able to come, I mean, the Niners were good before I got there. You know, Notre Dame was good, you know, but I felt like I helped take them to another level.
Right.
You know, and that's what's so awesome about it. And I was a integral part of all of those teams winning. And so that I'm very proud of and that I was, you know, the every down back. I mean, I wasn't coming out the game, especially with the Niners. I mean,
that's awesome.
I never came out. You know how they do now. They're kind of first down back, second down back, and the third down back. But, you know, it was me for all of that stuff back then. And I dedicate a lot of that to, number one, my mentors, but then being around all you guys, man, and the camaraderie that we had and the fact that we pushed each other so much. Because when I first went there, I went to Notre Dame. That's when I really took off because I wasn't lifting weights really in high school like that. I was trying, you know, but really I wasn't a big weightlifter until I got to college. And then I was like, man, seeing everybody lifting the weights. And then we were doing all the, you know, we would do the plyometrics and jumping on those boxes. And
all the
things that we were doing, especially like you said, in the summertime and spring ball, like we were really getting after it. And I felt like I was in the best shape of my life, number one. But also that mentally I was becoming a better player all the time because I was around so many great players and that I could look at and I could learn from and I could take a little bit from this person, take a little bit from that person. You know, I see you in there in the weight room, so I roll my little sleeves up, you know, going there. You know how I used to do, coming there, talking smack and everything. And it just was so much fun to be around people who you can be competitive with like that and still have fun with them. You know, we had fun. You know, even us as running backs, man, we had so many great running backs there. And some of them had to leave. Dorsey Levins even left, and he became a great running back.
Right.
You know, at Green Bay and stuff. So it's like that just shows the kind of players that we had, but we also had that camaraderie, man. And that's what's so cool about it. Like my man Cookie, man, that's another person who's not with us anymore. But you know, he was awesome guy to be around. Bettis is a great guy to be around. If I see Bettis right now, he gonna come over big as he is and hug the mess out of me and squeeze me, you know. And I do the same thing for him, you know. So it's just really awesome the guys that we played with, number one. But like I said, how cool everybody was, how competitive we were, but how we never let it boil over to where we didn't like each other or we started. Right. We never broke into fractions where a lot of teams do. They break into fractions and they're talking about this guy over here or they're mad at the quarterback or guys are getting in a room talking about this guy.
Exactly.
We never did that kind of stuff. I never remember anything like that. It was always like we're together trying to win a national championship and trying to be the best team that we could possibly be.
So you've had an opportunity to be on three different professional teams.
Yes.
And you've made the Pro Bowl five times.
Yes.
Okay, so you kind of know where I'm going with this one. So last year, you were a semifinalist for the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Is that correct?
Yes.
I can't. What is that feeling? I mean, I understand it may take a year or two for you. But what's that feeling that you're so close?
Yeah, even to be noticed like that and to be put in that realm of even, you know, one of the best players to ever play the game and being, I guess, immortalized like that.
Sure.
You know, with the busk and all that kind of stuff, you know, that would obviously be a great thing for me and a dream come true. But it would also be for my family, you know, I think of it that way now as a legacy to my kids so that they can go and say, man, that's my dad, you know, and they can take people there and they can see me and stuff like that. You know, if that were to happen and, you know, I feel like I, you know, had a great career and, you know, some days would happen as well. It would just be so good to be named with those guys who I used to look up to and who I wanted to be like, you know, and try to pattern my game after. Shoot, one of the guys from your team, Walter Payton, was one of my favorites of all time. And so when I passed a milestone where I'd played over 100 straight games in the pros and only behind Walter Payton, who had like 130 or 140 straight. So crazy that he played.
That's
so
amazing.
He almost played like his whole career without missing a game. So amazing to see a person like that, you know, and try to be like him. And I remember having him, I had on my wall, you know, I had that poster on my wall and I'm going to be just like that guy. I had him, I had Tony Dorsett and I love those guys. You could not tell me I wasn't going to be those guys and to actually have a chance to almost, you know, I'm obviously on myself, but to be on that level that they were on and to do the things that they were able to do and, you know, obviously to get to the Hall of Fame would just be that icing on the cake.
Well, here's the amazing part. And you talked about two incredible running backs, but you also have to realize that, you know, there were young kids that had Ricky Waters on their wall as well. And, well, no, but I'm serious.
Really close,
the idea that, you know, for you, you pointed out two phenomenal running backs, right? But there was a point when there were little 15, 16, 18-year-old kids in college and also younger that had posters of you up. And that's sometimes for me, when I know people like yourself, it's kind of amazing because it's like, wow, you know, I used to shower with him or we used to have dinner together and, you know, we were boys. And so when I hear people talk about you and Todd and Tony and Ricky and Tim Ryan, and I mean the list goes on. But it's like I feel special because I knew them outside of this amazing legacy that they've created for themselves. Like, you know, we're in class together. Although you are a really good student, and so I wasn't in class with you, but you know, I was in class with other guys. But it was amazing because, like, we all, like you mentioned before, we had this common bond, and that common bond was making each other successful.
Yes.
So I think that's what, when you get these young kids who have people like you on their walls, you know, it's amazing because you were in their shoes one time, and you had Peyton and you had Dorsett on your wall. So, you know, you talked about creating a legacy. You know, it's amazing when you think about what the sport has given you, but also has given kids the opportunity who may not reach the levels that you have reached, opportunities in life, right? And so, you know, they may not have gone to college, but because they saw you work hard, they worked hard, and now they've been successful in life, right? Or maybe they did have a chance to go to college. You know, he or she may have had an opportunity to be successful because they've been able to see what you've been able to overcome and accomplish in your life. And so that's what I think, like this whole big old thing that we're involved in sports, that's why I think it's so important, because we've learned so much, if not more, on a field, court, / pool, whatever, than we do in the classroom sometimes.
Yes, and I use those same work habits that I learned on that football field and that I learned growing up in this manner and everything that I do. I take that into everything that I do, and I think that I've instilled that into my kids, you know, both my boys. I feel like they're, you know, about being the best they can be. You know, I feel like they're very focused. They don't play football. They saw me and saw my friends and stuff, and they said, man, I don't see how y'all can play that sport. And I remember when my son, my oldest one, Ricky, when he said, Dad, you know, I hope you don't mind if I don't want to play football. And it's all right.
When you heard you were like,
Yeah, inside a little bit, but I was like, yeah, man, do you, you know what I mean? Be yourself. And he loves music, and he's a communications major with a minor in chemistry. And so he's, you know, he's his own guy for sure. You know, he's doing his thing, and it's just fun to see him like that. And he's martial artist. Everything, a lot of things I taught him, he's taking it to like a whole nother level. You know, even like music and the things that I know about music and like teaching them how to rap and different stuff like that. But now he's playing the piano and the guitar, and he's like, I mean, he's doing all these things. He's singing and all that. Actually, check him out. RickyWatersJr.com. I got to give him a little shout out.
Oh, okay. Yeah, please do. Absolutely. Here, let me plug that right quick. Kind of along those lines, as I make sure I do this. Hold on. Tell me a little bit about what you think leadership means to you.
Well, leadership, I think the best way to lead is by example. And I think that, you know, it's one of those things, you know, what you do speaks so loudly, I can't even hear what you say. You know, I don't think it's a lot about a bunch of talking. I think it's important that you are able to get across to other people what you're trying to convey to them. You have to be able to, you know, speak properly and everything. But really, I think it's about doing it yourself, and then for people to follow suit like that. So I think also being a leader means that you don't see yourself as better than anyone else. You don't see yourself as over top of someone else. You're just one of the players like everyone else. You know, and you want to be the best you can be. You want to help them be the best they can be. I think leadership is like that. And I think that a lot of times leadership is not one person. It's multiple people who you can bounce things off of, that you can learn from. I know like with us, you know, we all have different personalities and everything. With me, you, and Todd, you know, we are the captains of our team and all that. You know, we did it maybe in a different way, but I think that we all had that same value structure and understanding of what we were trying to get accomplished. And I think that that's why it worked. And when I got with the Niners and I saw Jerry Rice, the way he worked, and I saw John Taylor, the way he worked, and all these amazing players that had me throwing up out there trying to run with them. I mean, I remember thinking, man, I'm from Notre Dame, man. We champions. You know, I'm in great shape, man. There's nothing y'all could possibly do to me that hasn't already been done. Man, we start running them hills, doing all the crazy stuff they do for 5 hours working out.
Jesus.
You know, we're on the – we go from the hill to the track to the weight room, and that's on the off season. And we're doing that kind of stuff. And it just like – I learned so much being around those guys, and I learned how to be humble, you know. I learned some humility as well because I was like, man, you know, nobody catch like me. And then they're just like – taking, you know, the judge machine,
right,
the wheels, and that shoots all the way back there for punts and stuff. They're taking it and aiming it right at themselves and catching the ball. Boom, and walking. And the first time I tried that, almost took my head off. I was like, oh my God. And it took me a while to be able to do it. I had to back up and I kind of caught one back farther and I would walk up to it. And I remember being able to finally walk up right to it and just catch it, just like that. Now, you know, but that kind of stuff, I think it's being around other people
who
teach you that. So if you think you know everything, or you think because I'm a leader or I'm the guy or I'm whatever, or I'm even the best athlete on the team or whatever, that is somehow just that right there makes you special. It doesn't. I think it takes more than that.
So as we're winding down, I apologize. I went over the time that I asked you to participate, but
good, my man.
What would you tell a 18-year-old Ricky Waters from all of your experiences now?
Yeah, I would say, man, make the best of this. If you're a prospect, like, you know, like I said, as far as choosing a school, don't go there on promises or what anybody's promising you. Go there because you like the school. You think you can be successful there. It's a great learning experience for you. At least it could be, you know, so you have to look at those things. And also to always be humble. That is a big part of it, being humble. Because if you start to think, you know, you're kind of this or that, and you will start to lay off of things. You won't work as hard as you should. You won't be as hungry as you should. You always keep that hunger, always keep that belief in yourself. That's important though. You can't go the other way and start like thinking, God, because you get around some other athletes. Like I said, I got around some athletes and they blowing my doors off. I remember I thought I was winning all the races. And I didn't know this guy named Rocket Ishmael had, you know, he had come. I saw him run track and everything when we were in high school. And I went and met him there, and he wanted me to be, you know, his. So I was his host. And,
wow.
You know, we had a good time and everything. But I'm still thinking I'm the fastest one. You know, I'm going to win these races. And I remember when we were running and I thought I was winning. And then I looked down and I didn't see, because you know how Rocket is. He will never want to brag. He's not one that's going to be in the middle. I'm right in the middle.
Right.
He's way down on the end. And he is blowing my doors off.
Wow.
And then Stan is down the other side. You know, and Pat Terrell is right there. You know, and all the guys, you know how fast these guys were. So it was amazing. But the humility is what you really have to understand that you always can get better. You can always, the whole time I was playing, I was always trying to get better. I was always trying to figure out something that would give me a nod on the other guy. Whatever it was, if I had to lose weight, gain some weight, get more muscle. There were so many different things. I tried different workouts that people were coming up with. Mm-hmm. I would, like I said, the jugs machine, all these things that, you know, people probably wouldn't even think about. You know, pulling the sleds, putting all that stuff on you, and you know, I don't even know if they do the stuff that we used to do. We just put weights on. I had weights on my whole body. I would have a vest.
Yep.
And running with all that stuff, combat boots. I would do anything I could to be the best I could be. So That's what I would say. Always remember, you can always get better. Always keep working. Always keep, because, you know, you either get better or worse. You never stay the same, you know.
Sure.
So that's the thing. You know, you have to believe that you have every day you have to work to get better. To get better, not just as a player, but as a person. Because the person you are is going to determine a lot, too. I feel like I get a lot of things because, you know, I give a lot to other people. I do a lot of charity work. I do a lot of mentoring myself and all those things. And I think that those are the things that come back to me. Am I perfect? No. Have I been perfect? No. No one is. But if you keep on believing that you can be a good person, then you will keep trying to be a good person and keep doing things that it takes to be a better person. But if you think you're already the best and you're already a great, great person and all that, then you won't do the things that you need to do to make yourself better.
That sounds great. You alluded before that you're involved in music. Is that what you're doing now? Like, can you share with us what Ricky Waters is doing now?
Well, actually, I am working with them and working with my kids and stuff, and especially Ricky with the music and stuff, just because it's so much fun and it's a way for us to, like I say, to bond.
Sure.
But really, a lot of what I've been doing since I retired, well, first I was doing the announcing and all that kind of stuff, and that was fun to do that. And I came back here to San Francisco, and I was able to do a lot of work for the 49ers in that capacity and meet a lot of people. So that was fun. But most of what I've been doing is with this pain management, because I've been hurting, and I know a lot of other people are hurting. So I've been working with different people to come up with a really good pain management system, and I've been able to do that, especially the last 3 years. I found a partner, and with my wife, that we're working on it, and we bonded with different people. You know, some people have the CBD, and the other people, they have the Ayurvedic essential oils and stuff.
Okay.
And we kind of like worked and mixed until we came up with a really good blend of just a pain management.
Okay.
So,
is there a website or anything I can direct folks to? Or,
oh yes, impact -wellness.com.
All right. Last couple of seconds. I'm gonna try to see if I can get it up there right quick, man. All right, so while I'm trying to type this in, you can kind of talk to me a little bit, man, because I'm trying to.
Yeah. Okay.
Tell me more about the. So, how did you? I mean, obviously, from injuries and stuff like that. But yeah. I mean, when did you figure out that, hey, maybe I can alleviate some of this pain, or maybe there's a better way than just popping pills or going to the doctor?
Exactly. That's what happened was I was on opioids, things like that. You know, I was taking those things and they would take away the pain some, but they would make me feel worse in other ways. And so I wanted to try to find a way that I could do it and without, you know, hurting myself more or hurting my body or my insides more or anything like that. You know, something that's more of a healthy benefit. Yeah, and it's just one of those things. I started with different things and all kind of. I mean, I have boxes and boxes of products that I've tried from different people and came up with the right thing, and it was just it's been awesome for me, and it's the only thing that helps me. My jaws, my neck, my back. You know, my knees, ankles. I mean, every day I could wake up with something. My toe could just not want to work from all the turf toes that I've had and things like that. So I needed something. And I needed a relief. And this right here was it. And it really helped me. I just can't believe how good it has been for me so far and how it's just changed everything. I wasn't sleeping well. I was waking up in the middle of the night because my shoulder would hurt or something would start aching. So I couldn't even sleep. So that's making me tired during the daytime. And I'm, you know, not my best. And so it was a tough thing. And then you get depressed. You know, a lot of things were going on.
Sure.
So it's just good that I found something that now I can sleep. I wake up energized. I'm better with my family, obviously. I'm not, you know, a little grumpier and all those things. So it really, really helped. It really
That's helped. Awesome. All right. Well, I'm going to have to check it out on a personal level as well. And you know, I think when folks have a chance to kind of see us in one way, and that's on the field and cheering for us. But oftentimes, you know, no one really understands what happens when you're done playing.
Yes.
Just from a mental aspect and also a physical aspect as well. Yes. You know, we've all seen Earl Campbell and, you know, being in a wheelchair and that's just a rough thing to see. And I think that's the black eye, so to speak, on the NFL is that, you know, they've improved, but there mm-hmm. isn't the proper care. I mean, I know when I was a union rep, we always talked about lifetime health care, but that's just not going to happen because of our sport. Right. And, you know, make it for, you know, after guys who are after 50, you know, give them lifetime health care or something like that. But, right. you know, it's something that's a very serious matter. And so hopefully folks can have a chance to check out Impact Wellness and see what's going on.
Yeah, it definitely it works right away. As soon as you put it on, you feel it. And the tincture, you know, you put under your tongue, that is just amazing for just relaxing you. Because I have a hard time just turning it off, too.
Okay.
Thinking about everything that's going on and thinking about things that have happened and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So it's good to be able to turn that off and kind of relax and
that's
be able
great.
To get your proper rest and wake up, you know, ready to go.
That's amazing. Well, Rick, man, this has been awesome.
Wifey brought me some.
Oh, there we go. See?
Right there.
All right.
Damn, that liquid gold right there.
Okay. Damn. Now, that's the correct website, right? Impact-wellness.com.
Yep.
Okay. And then I'll actually put that on my my Twitter and Facebook page as well. Before I go, though, you mentioned some guys, Andre Jones, George Williams, Rodney Culver, and that's just to name a few. I think I mentioned Dean Brown. These are folks that were part of this camaraderie that Ricky was talking about that unfortunately are no longer with us. And, you know, it's tough because these are guys that we kind of grew up with. We hung out with, we laughed with, we cried with, we won with, we bled with, we sweat with. And, you know, a lot of those guys have families. And, you know, we're here kind of hanging out, shooting the shit, talking about these great times. And, you know, I always think about, you know, those guys because we lost them at such a young age. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's so sad. So I just wanted to kind of acknowledge those guys for being part of my experience, the success I had, because if not for those guys, I'm not sure where I'd be. And I didn't name everybody. Unfortunately, there's a long list, but you know, a shout out to those guys and the idea that they have family and friends that miss them dearly.
Yeah, no doubt.
Well, so this was awesome. We actually need to do more because there's a whole bunch of stuff. We didn't dive into your book. I mean, there's 1,000 things that we haven't talked about. You got to promise me we will do this again.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
All right, cool. It's been awesome. Folks on Facebook Live, thank you very much for watching. Most of all, I want to thank my producer, wife, director, Candy Rose.
Yeah.
And if you guys enjoy this interview, please check out my YouTube page at YouTube Chris Zorich 50. And you'll get the interviews. I mentioned I interviewed Todd and also Pat. They had some great stories about Ricky, so you can check that out. Rick, man, this was awesome, man. I look forward to kind of doing it again. And please tell your wife thank you for helping us out with the lighting. We had a chance to see your pretty face, so that was good. Thanks, brother. Bro, this has been a blast, and I cannot wait to see you in person, man.
Right on. Same here, man. You know, it's always great to hang out.
And then I know I promised before that I'm gonna get our class together on a big Zoom. I'm still working on that. So I'll see you then. All right, brother. Yeah. All right, man.
Love you, bro.
I love you too, bro. Bye bye.